concurrent subgroup in SL2. And Kai was a character of Z mod NZ star. And now we are writing GL2 because we have moved on to the adales and want to treat general Kai. And G of R plus was the connected component of GL2 of R, namely the determinant, positive determinant ones. And then we defined a subset of the, we defined adales and finite adales. We also defined a subgroup of the group of finite adales, sorry, of GL2 over finite adales, namely something which resembled gamma naught of N. Okay, so that group was called K naught of N. What was it? You take the product over all primes of matrices A, B, C, D, which are integral over in GL2 of ZP, such that C was congruent to 0 modulo N. Okay, so K naught of N was defined exactly like gamma naught of N was defined. And we had put a topology on all these groups, and K naught of N was compact open. Then we defined a character of K naught of N using exactly the same prescription with which we defined chi on gamma naught of N, right? Chi was on Z mod NZ star, Z star. And on gamma naught of N, we had taken, defined a character taking ABCD to chi of D. And similarly, we had this chi K naught of N. And then to so given a modular form F of weight K and level chi, we wanted to extend it to G of A, think of it as a function on G of A over G of Q, for which we had two particular observations. Firstly, was that G of A was the product of G of Q, G of R plus and K naught of N. This was strong approximation plus a little bit more. And then gamma naught of N was the set of those matrices in G of Q, which over the finite adales belong to K naught of N and on the real place had positive determinant. So with these two observations, we were able to assign to each F in MK of gamma naught of N comma chi a function from GL2 over the adales to the complex numbers. Okay. So how did we define the function? By the first of the 2 points, we could write any element G in GL2 over the adales as a product of something in GL2 of Q times something in GL2 of R plus times something in K naught of N. Okay, so if you had this product, that went to the following expression. First of all, you totally ignore GQ because the function was to be left GL2 of Q invariant. And you take the G infinity factor and use exactly what was used to extend the function to SL2 of R modulo gamma naught of N. Okay. So what is written in blue is the Archimedean thing. There you do exactly what you did for SL2, except that you put a determinant factor in. And then on the K naught of N part, you compensate for the Nebentypers so that you get something which was on GL2 of A modulo GL2 of Q. Okay. So this was the definition of VF. Okay. So let us go ahead. So let us recall some notational changes. Now G is GL2. Henceforth, G0 will be GL2 of R, that is frac G0, and math frac of G will be GL2 of C, which was M2 of C. Okay, and earlier K was the compact open subgroup, compact subgroup SO2 of R in SL2 of R. Now K infinity is going to be the maximal compact subgroup O2 of R of GL2 of R. With this G and K infinity, we will talk about G, K infinity modules later. Okay, so, and remember, we also defined Z to be the center of G, namely set of all scalar matrices. And to our chi, which was a Dirichlet character on Z mod NZ star, we attached a character of the ideal class group A star mod Q star. And that character also we denote by chi. And once you have that, because Z of A is isomorphic to A star. I made a typo here, as you can see. Z of R should be set of all Z 0, 0, Z such that Z belongs to R star, okay, not R. Okay, because you want invertible matrices, right? So that there had to be question. R star. Sorry?
There is a question in the chat.
Sorry, can you read it out?
There is no Q, GQ involved in the definition. Why?
That was the previous page, right?
Yes.
Yeah, so we are trying to define a function which is left invariant under GL2 of Q. Okay, so whatever we define has to be independent of GQ. Okay, that is one thing, but there is something to check, right? Given the same element G, I might be able to write it as GQ, G infinity, G K naught of n in two different ways. Okay, so one needs to check that if you write it as this product in two different ways, you will get the same value for phi f. Okay, so I sketched yesterday how to verify that it involved the second factor, like, you know, the second thing that G of Q intersection this product was gamma naught of n. Okay, so that so there is some verification there to be done, but otherwise one can define it this way, and then it is left invariant under GL2 of Q. Is there any question, or does that answer the question? Or
Chalit, does it answer your question? I think yes.
Okay, so I'll then proceed. Okay, so there is a typo here. Z of R is set of all z zero zero z such that z belongs to R star. So z of A is isomorphic to A star, right? So we had the character chi on A star. So chi can also be thought of as a character on z of A. We take its inverse to be omega chi. Okay, so we define a character on the center of GL2 of A as the inverse of the character attached to the chi that we had. So there is another chat. Can you see what is that?
Thanks.
Ah, okay. Thanks. Okay. So this was the prescription for phi f. And yesterday we also looked at what were the properties of phi f. So let us go over the properties. So first of all, it was first property was left G of Q invariance. Okay, that is, you see, when you look at the definition of EF, there was no G of Q on the left. It did not depend on GQ. Therefore, if you multiply on the left by gamma, that doesn't change the value of phi, which is phi F. Okay, so that was the first property. Second property was a smoothness property. Okay, so on the SL2 of our mod gamma naught of n situation, the function that you obtained was smooth. So here on G of A also, there is a sense in which the function is smooth. Okay, what does that mean? The idea is that it has to be separately smooth in G of AF and in G of R. So let us write that. So G of A is G of AF cross G of R. So you fix the G of AF component look at it as a function on the G of R part alone, then it has to be smooth. Okay, so in fact, the same proof as before works. So let us look at the case where G can be written as GQ, G infinity, G K naught of n. What will happen if you change G infinity? When you are changing G infinity here, what changes is exactly as the function we had defined for SL2 of R modulo gamma naught of n, which also worked for GL2 of R modulo gamma naught of n. Okay. So if you look at the blue part, that blue part is a smooth thing in the GL2 of R part. So you can believe that at least in this situation, the same proof shows that if you change G infinity, the function is going to change smoothly. So that you can use to see, actually it's pretty easy that if you fix the G of AF component, it's going to be smooth as a function of G of R. Second thing is that if you fix the G of R part, okay, if you fix the G of R part, then it is going to be smooth as a function of the G of AF part. Okay, so why does this follow? It follows from the fact that if you change your G by G times K naught, okay, so look at the GQ, G infinity, G K naught of n. If I multiply by K naught, which also belongs to K naught of n, the function is going to be multiplied by chi K naught of n of K naught inverse, right? And the kernel of chi K naught of n was an open compact subgroup, as we discussed yesterday. And therefore, it is right invariant under some compact open subgroup of G of AF. Okay, so this is the meaning of the function being smooth under G of AF when you fix the G of R factor. Okay, so on this slide, all the infinity or Archimedean factor, R factor, is going to be written in blue. All the finite ideals factors will be written in magenta. Okay, so the third is the weight or K finiteness. If you change by G by G times R of theta, phi of G becomes phi of G times exp of ik theta. okay, where r of theta this time belongs to SO2 of r. It is not k infinity because k infinity is O of r, but SO2 of r is finite index in O2 of r. So that is still finiteness under O2 of r. Okay. So why is this? Again, look at the blue part. So if you multiply GQ, G infinity, G K naught of n by r of theta, you see you can commute G K naught of n and the r of theta with G K naught of n because G of AF and G of r commute. So the same proof as the last time, as in the SL2 of r case works. So you get this equation. Okay. Second was the Casimir slash eigenvalue finiteness. Namely, your function is on G of AF cross G of r. And once through the G of r factor, you can make the Lie algebra also act with the same prescription that we had defined before, because you can think of you can so for instance, you can fix the G of AF factor and look at it as a function on G of r and apply the Casimir. Okay. So that's why I have written omega in blue. It sees only the G of r factor. If you apply omega to it, what you get is a multiple of the function phi, and that multiple depends on the weight of the modular form. Okay. So this is exactly a generalization of the property that we had seen for SL2 of r mod gamma naught of n. The third property was the central character property. From chi, we had defined a character omega chi of the center Z of A. So if you change G to ZG, you get omega chi of z times phi of g. Fourth was a growth condition. Okay, and finally, if f is a cusp form, we had this cuspidality condition that we stated last time. Okay, and again, remember this means that there is only one cusp, essentially, if you work over adails. So all these properties are actually straightforward adaptations of those that came from the SL2 of r mod gamma naught situation. So you see, although you might think that adails are a very clumsy ring, you know, how does even one work with a clumsy ring like that? But it's actually very simple. Already we saw that G of A splits into G of AF and G of R. And we will see soon that studying something over G of A in most cases reduces to studying over individual places. So at a given point of time, you will have to think only about G of R factor or G of QP factor. So it's actually pretty easy, and it's not at all different from what we have already seen. Okay, so you will see in due course of time that this is not hard at all. Okay, so and one can show that the map F goes to phi F goes from SK of gamma naught of n phi, which was the space of cusp comma chi, which was the space of cusp forms, to the space which satisfies all the conditions mentioned in the previous page, including the last one. Okay, so I'm skipping the proof. It is, of course, not immediate, but it is along the lines of what we have discussed before. The Casimir eigenvalue and the weight together will imply the holomorphy of the function that you can obtain from phi and so on. Okay, and finally, there is something that you can do for mass cusp forms, but we already saw in the SL2 of r mod gamma naught of n case that we can work with generalized mass cusp forms. So from now on, I'll be thinking mostly only about the holomorphic forms case. So all of this motivates the following definition of an automorphic form. Let omega be any finite order character of Z of A over Z of Q, where Z is the center. Okay, so maybe it is enough to assume that omega is continuous and unitary, but many of the sources that I refer to start with this sort of an omega. So let us assume it doesn't hurt. So let omega be such a character. We want to define the space of automorphic forms. So by an automorphic form with central character omega, so we always define the central character before defining the automorphic form. We are thinking of a function from G of A to C which satisfies the following properties. Firstly, it is left invariant under G of Q. Namely, it should descend to a function from G of A mod G of Q to C. Second condition is smoothness along the lines of what we had seen before. Once we fix the G of AF component, then as a function of the G infinity component, it should be smooth on G of R plus. Two slides ago, I wrote G of R, but the two don't really make any difference. They just differ by translations, given that the function is G of Q invariant. The second was that it should be smooth on the G of A factor. Namely, it is right invariant under some compact open subgroup of G of AF. Okay. So in the earlier, in the phi F situation, it was the kernel of chi, which was viewed as a function on gamma k naught of n. Okay. So this was our smoothness. So when we do a representation theory at the periodic places, this notion of smoothness is what is going to manifest as the notion of smoothness for periodic representations over of G of QP. Then the next two two conditions are analogous to the corresponding conditions for SL2 of R mod gamma naught of n. First is that just like our function on SL2 of R had to be SO2 of R finite, this time you are requiring the function to be finite under the right regular action of O2 of R. Namely, phi should be contained in some finite dimensional space of functions on G of A over G of Q, which is stable under the right regular action of K infinity. Okay, so that is the first condition. In the second condition, ignore Z of G. You can just think of it as the Casimir omega. Your function should be contained in some finite dimensional space of functions on G of A over G of Q, which are stable under omega, okay, and which are in particular smooth, okay. So for those who are comfortable with Lie algebra, Z of G is the center of the universal enveloping algebra of GL2 of C. So the third condition was that it has a central character omega, namely phi of ZG should be omega of Z times phi of G for all Z and G. So this actually implied that in two, you don't have to worry about the entire universal enveloping center of the universal enveloping algebra. Only the Casimir is enough. Fourth is some growth condition. Okay. So most of these details will not concern us for most of the times. Now that we have defined an automorphic form, we define A of G of A over G of Q comma omega to be the space of automorphic forms with central character omega. Okay. So this is just the definition. In fact, I showed this slide very quickly last time.
Sir, okay. The condition two. So, if you think of automorphic forms and L2 functions.
Yeah.
And this, how does Casimir act? That infinity part only.
So first of all, not every L2 function is smooth, right?
A smooth function.
So you should look at L2 intersection C in infinity.
Okay.
Casimir acts only on the G of R part. So let me verbally say, so how did you make the Lie algebra of G act on functions on G of R? We right multiplied by exponential of Tx, right?
Yes.
We considered something like f of G times exp of Tx minus f of G divided by T, right?
Yes.
The same thing applies here also, okay? So if you multiply G by exp of Tx, what will happen is that only G infinity will get multiplied by exp of Tx. The finite ideal part will remain the same.
Okay.
So we are just looking at it as a function of G of R as after fixing the finite ideal thing. Okay. Finite ideal component.
I have a question. This omega, we can also think of coming from like some omega f that you would, omega of pi.
Yeah. So that's exactly the standard example that we have in mind. Omega is omega chi. Namely, chi was a character of Z mod NZ star. We viewed it as a character of A star mod Q star. And then on the center of G, we took Z0, 0, Z2, the inverse of that. The inverse of chi applied to Z. Yeah. Right?
Okay, so that's the same. This is the same.
Sorry?
This will correspond to that only.
Yeah, so that is the standard example that we have in mind here.
My doubt was, so any such omega will just come out like that, right? We can just think of, or there are some other omega.
Yeah, so in fact, you can consider omega which is not a finite order and make these definitions, okay?
Okay.
So many sources finite, actually treat more general omega, but we are just restricting to this case, that's all. Okay. Yeah. So in fact, I made another mistake. See, on the top, omega is a character valued in C star, not C. Okay. On the first line.
Yeah.
Okay. So that was a typo. It should be C star. Okay. So does that answer your question? Sorry.
Yes, yes. Thank
okay,
you.
Thanks. Okay, so let's move ahead. So again, we have the same cuspidality condition. We say that phi is cuspidal if for all g in g of a, phi of 1x0 1 times g times dx is 0. So think of that g. So this is like f integral f of x plus iy dx, where x varies from 0 to 1. Okay. So a mod q is analogous to r mod z, which is like closed interval 0, 1. And allowing that g to vary is like allowing y to vary on the upper half plane. Okay. So let a naught, okay, that subscript 0 stands for cuspidality. So let a naught of g of a over g of q comma omega denote the space of cuspidal automorphic forms or cusp forms. Okay. So this is the comment that I had made about the cusps. When you were dealing with SL2 of R mod gamma naught of n, it was enough to worry about the cusp I infinity. Now, and we had, sorry, it was not enough to worry about it, because if you acted on SL by SL2Z, I infinity would go to many inequivalent cusps, and we had to worry about all of those. In the Adelic framework, we don't have to worry about those. So basically, we have to only worry about one cusp, which is basically represented by a set of all matrices of this form, A, B, 0, D. Okay, so this 1x0, 1 that you see here, the 0 being on the lower triangulars, in some sense, it stands for the cusp at I infinity, because that is what stabilizes infinity. Okay. Anyway, I mean is that Adelic framework allows us some amount of simplification. Okay. So now we want to study the action of gk infinity and g of a finite on the space of automorphic forms. So remember that we considered automorphic forms for SL2 of R modulo gamma, and it did not have an action of SL2 of R. Why? If you write multiply by SL2 of R, that is, if you consider the right regular representation of SL2 of R, that destroys SO2 of R finiteness. Okay, so original phi was SO2 R finite, but if you consider phi of g times k, that may not be. If you consider phi of g times g1 instead of phi of g as a function of g, that may not be SO2 or finite. Okay, and that is why we had to view it as SL2 of C comma SO2 of our module. Okay, so both the Lie algebra SL2 of C and the compact subgroup SO2 of R, both of this acted on A of SL2 of R mod gamma. Okay, so something similar happens here. A of G of A over G of Q comma omega is not a G of R module for the same reason. Right multiplication by G of R destroys K infinity finiteness. On the other hand, recall that we wrote G naught for GL2 of R, G for GL2 of C, and K infinity for O2 of R. It is easy to see that right multiplication by K infinity preserves the space exactly as right multiplication by SO2R preserved A of SL2 of R mod gamma. Okay, using smoothness on the G of R factor, we can make G naught and G act on elements of A of G of A over G of Q comma omega. So how does this work? This these act exactly like I discussed with Malleshyam a few minutes ago. You just multiply by exp of tx, subtract the original function, and divide by t and take the limit. Okay, so the functions are smooth on G of R factor. That tells you that G naught and therefore G also act on this space. So although capital G of R did not act, both the Lie algebra G and K infinity both act on the space of automorphic forms. Okay, so this is not entirely obvious, because you have to show that when you act upon by the Lie algebra, the growth conditions are preserved, but that can be done. Okay, then you also have right translation by G of AF, and the claim is that this does preserve G of A over G of Q, automorphic forms on G of A over G of Q. And why is that? Clearly, when you right multiply by G of AF, it does not affect the left G of Q invariance. And clearly, it does not affect the central character. And it does not affect invariance under compact open subgroups of G of AF, because if you right translate by G, and the original thing was invariant under K prime, the new thing will be invariant under G inverse K prime G. And finally, there are conditions involving G of R factor, such as smoothness and so on, and Casimir, G of AF does not see that because the actions of G of AF and G of R commute. Okay. But anyway, you can take this as a black box or you can verify the details later. So the point is that G of R does not act on the space of automorphic forms. Nevertheless, three objects act. The Lie algebra G, then K infinity, and also G of AF. All of these three act on the space of automorphic forms. Okay. So let me summarize that. Although G of A, so that's also a typo. It had to be A of G of A over G of Q comma omega in the summary. Okay. So the actions of G, you do have actions of G and K infinity, and there is a certain compatibility between them because both of them came from the action of G of R. So you can think of A of G of A over G of Q comma omega as a G K infinity module. Okay. So don't worry, you will learn to black box all of these things. You don't have to, most of the time the details won't bother you. And then you have an action of G of AF by right regular, which is smooth in the sense that every vector is fixed by a compact open subgroup, right? This was the smoothness condition that was there on the automorphic forms. Namely, every function was invariant under right multiplication, right translation by some compact open subgroup. Okay, moreover, you had the action of K and infinity from the Archimedean place. Then you have the actions of G of AF. These two commute with each other. Why? Because G of AF and G of R both commute with each other. Okay. Therefore, these actions don't see each other. Therefore, the actions of G, K infinity and the action of G of AF, both of these commute with each other. Okay. So this is analogous to the following. Recall that if we have a representation of G1 cross G2, the actions of G1 and G2 commute with each other by the definition of a representation, right? Because G1 cross 1 and 1 cross G2 commute with each other. Okay. So the space of automorphic forms is only a G of AF cross G comma K infinity module. But for simplicity, you can think of it as a representation of G of A, which is G of AF cross G of R. Okay. When the occasion demands, at that time, we will stop thinking of it as a G of R thing and only remember the action of the pair G comma K infinity. Okay. But it is okay for practical purposes to think of it as a module for G of A. Any questions? Okay. Let us move ahead then. So just like for G, sorry, there was a question.
No question.
Okay. Okay. So just like we defined the notion of an admissible G comma K, GK module in the SL2R situation, here the analogous thing is going to be an admissibility for G of AF cross G comma K infinity modules. Okay. So don't worry again, although things look bulky, all the contributions from the place is split. So this is not going to be difficult. And in any case, the word admissibility is going to keep appearing, but we will not have to work with the precise definition most of the time. Okay. So the definition is the exact analog of what we saw earlier. Namely, given any compact subgroup KF in G of AF, which is compact and open, and a representation sigma F of that compact open subgroup, and given any irreducible representation of K infinity, call it sigma infinity, you can consider the representation sigma F cross tensor sigma infinity of KF cross K infinity. It should occur only finitely many times in V. Okay. So even if the definition might look intimidating, if you are not comfortable with the representation theory, we won't have to use this definition. Just remember that there is an analogous notion of admissibility. Okay. So why I'm stating this, it is to state a theorem that I had stated earlier. So Harishchandra had proved the following theorem in great generality. We saw this in lecture 2 also. The space of all automorphic forms for central character omega, you see, it is the space, so the entire space is not an admissible G of AF cross G K infinity module. But if you look at the subspace which is annihilated by a certain ideal in the universal enveloping algebra of finite co-dimension, then that is admissible. Okay. So it is okay if you don't follow the theorem. All that, the moral that I want to say is that the classical results like mk of gamma naught of n comma chi, etc., being finite dimensional, gets captured in terms of the notion of admissibility in the setting of g of af cross g comma k infinity modules. Okay, so that annihilated by I is just like fixing a Laplacian eigenvalue. That ideal could be something like the Casimir operator minus k squared minus 1 by 4 comma something from the center. But yeah, anyway, okay, so now finally we can define what is the meaning of an automorphic representation. Okay, so roughly speaking, an automorphic representation is an irreducible admissible g of af cross g k infinity module which is contained in the space of automorphic forms with central character omega. Okay, so I put contained in quotes. What does it precisely mean? It should be isomorphic to a subquotient of. Okay, so again, people might define this notion in slightly different ways. So in context where you want to think of an automorphic form as a subrepresentation, you might think of the automorphism as the representation together with the embedding into L2, but those subtleties we won't have to worry about. Okay, so then you can define the notion of cuspidal automorphic representation. Instead of considering the whole of A of G of A over G of Q, you only consider A naught of G of A over G of Q. Okay, and then there is also an L2 version of similar concepts. Namely, what is the definition of L2 of G of A over G of Q comma omega? So the one thing is that functions in L2 are not really functions. They are equivalence classes because two functions which are equal almost everywhere are considered the same. So you have to pay attention to some subtlety of that sort. But otherwise, it is exactly what you would expect. Because you are writing g of a over g of q, the functions have to be left invariant under g of q. Okay, so phi of gamma g is phi of g. Then there is a central character condition. Phi of zg should be omega of z times phi of g. Okay, now you might ask, why do I write for all z element of z of a and not for almost all z element of z of a? So I think you can always choose some function in its almost everywhere equivalence class which satisfies this property for all z. Okay, so it's enough to check the, do that. And finally, the L2 condition. Okay, what is the L2 condition? So if you take the absolute value of f, absolute value of f is a function not just on g of a over g of q. It is actually well defined on g of a over z of a g of q. Why? Because phi of zg is omega of z times phi of g, right? So if you take absolute value of phi of zg, you get absolute value of omega of z times absolute value of phi of g. But omega is a unitary character, so absolute value of omega of z is 1. Okay, so absolute value of z, absolute value of f does not change if you left multiply by an element of z. So you need to take the integral only over g of a over z of a times g of q. Okay, thanks to the central character being unitary. Okay, so this is the L2 condition. If you integrate, you should get something less than infinity. Okay, now you might ask, what is the measure on g of a over z of a g of q? So if you know something about generalities of measures on locally compact groups, both z of a g of q and g of a are unimodular, and therefore the quotient has a unique right g of a invariant measure. So you can talk about dg. Okay, so that measure is unique up to scaling. So then which functions are in L2 is well defined. Okay, so g of a over g of q z of a has actually finite volume because that looks like some kind of compact extension of upper half plane modulo SL2Z, and upper half plane modulo SL2Z has finite volume, whereas g of a mod g of q has infinite volume. Okay, so this is the definition of the L2 space. Okay, and remember, the space of all automorphic forms is not contained in L2. Okay, so for instance, functions like the Eisenstein series are not going to belong to L2. But if you look at only the cuspidal automorphic forms, they are going to belong to L2. Okay. So now you might think that, you know, this integral, that I wrote g of a over g of q z of a, it looks like a horrible thing. Actually, it is not horrible at all. We can relate it to something that you have already seen about cusp forms. So you start with f in sk of gamma naught and comma chi and set omega to be omega chi. So you know that phi f actually belongs to a naught of g of a over g of q comma omega, which is contained in L2. Okay. So you can ask, what is the norm of phi f in this space L2 of g of a over g of q comma omega? Okay. So can you guess what it is? It is exactly the Peterson inner product of f with itself. Okay. Peterson norm of f. Okay. So that is something that you can check up to the normalization of measures. Okay. So the L2 norm on g of a over g of q z of a is nothing surprising. Okay. And that y raised to k had in some sense showed up in the form of y raised to k by 2 sometime back. Okay, but that's okay. Okay, and just like we had a naught contained in A, you can also define L02 contained in L2. Namely, you impose the same cuspidality condition, except that this time you say for almost all g in g of A. Okay, so that's because things are in L2. Okay, and one can show that a naught of g of a over g of q comma omega is the space of automorphic forms that belong to L02 of g of a over g of q comma omega. Any questions?
Not yet.
Okay, so let me continue. So I have to now make an embarrassing correction of some very horribly wrong statement I made in lecture 2. So here I just repeated the claim that A02 is the space of automorphic forms that belong to L02, which is analogous to the fact that a naught of gamma SL2 of R mod gamma naught of N is the space of automorphic forms in L02 of SL2 of R mod gamma naught of N. Okay, so the correction is that in lecture 2, I stated this very wrongly. I said that a naught was simply the space of k finite vectors in L02 of SL2 of R mod gamma naught of N. And Professor Ghate told me that I had to be careful here. So in fact, one can disprove the wrong claim. Okay, so let me sketch how to disprove what I wrote. Okay, so this is not going to be needed, but to repent for my sin, I have to kind of disprove what I said. Okay, so here is a classical fact. One knows that there are infinitely many S for which there are classical mass forms. Sorry, that's a typo. It should have been classical mass cusp forms. Okay, not just classical mass forms, but mass cusp forms. Otherwise, I cannot construct my cuspidal counterexample. Okay, infinitely many cusp forms S for which the space of classical mass cusp forms of Laplacian eigenvalue lambda of S is non-empty. Okay, now if you pull them up to SL2 of R modulo gamma naught of N. Okay, for classical mass cusp forms, the association of phi f was very easy. You just pull back from upper half plane to SL2 of R. Okay, and they are all fixed by SO2 of R. Okay, and therefore, if you take a convergent infinite linear combination of those, norm something like things of norm 1 by n squared or something and add them up, that sum will be convergent, that sum will be fixed by SO2 of R. So it will be SO2 of R finite, but it will not be omega finite because there are infinitely many S involved. Okay, so that will be a counterexample to what I said. So that's a horribly wrong statement. Perhaps omega finiteness plus SO2 of R finiteness is enough. But I haven't checked that carefully, but please note that I stand corrected on that. Okay. So with that, with a slightly lighter conscience, let me move to the statement about decomposition. So this is also some fact that we had seen in lecture 2, but the adelic version of that. So A of g of a over g of q comma omega, the space of automorphic forms, as a g of a f cross g comma k infinity module, cannot be written as a direct sum of irreducible modules. Okay, but if you look at the cuspidal space, you can. Okay, so there is this following result of Gelfand, Grave, and Piatersky Shapiro, which they proved in great generality. The result says that if you restrict to just a naught, that is going to be a direct sum of irreducible g of a f cross g comma k infinity modules, each occurring with finite multiplicity. Okay. In fact, for GL2 or even GLN, the multiplicity is actually going to be 1, but that we'll probably only state next time. Okay, so the space of cusp forms does have complete reducibility. You have various irreducible modules, each with finite multiplicity, and there is a Hilbert space version. If you look at L2 on that G of A acts, okay, on the space of automorphic forms, G of A does not act because G of A was a space of very special functions. But the space of L2, G of A definitely acts. And if you restrict to the space L02, then this is saying that on L02, the action of G of A decomposes as a direct sum of topologically irreducible closed subrepresentations, each occurring with finite multiplicity. Okay. So again, obviously, we are not going to prove it. It's a very non-trivial result. But I'll kind of give you a very rough idea. You know, I sort of sketched it, verbally set some idea in the second lecture. So here I'll try to explain it slightly better as to why how this sort of a result is proved. So roughly speaking, what is the meaning of decomposing into a direct sum of irreducible representations? In some sense, it is a generalization of the notion of eigenvalue decomposition, right? If you have any vector space, and if you have a linear operator on that vector space, you can think of that linear operator as a representation of the group Z. Okay? And the eigenvalue decomposition of that space is the decomposition of that operator into irreducible or indecomposable subrepresentations. Okay? In general, if you have an operator on a Hilbert space, there is no reason why that operator will have anything resembling an eigenvalue decomposition. Okay? There are special operators for which you have eigenvalue decomposition, right? What is one of the kind of operator on a Hilbert space which has an eigenvalue decomposition? We study about compact self-adjoint operators. If you have a compact self-adjoint operator on a Hilbert space, that does have an eigenvalue decomposition. Okay? So, roughly speaking, the idea is from the right regular representation of G of A on this space, can you produce compact operators? Okay? So if you fix an element of G and consider the right regular action, that is going to be far from compact. Okay? The image of the unit ball is going to be the unit ball again, which is far from compact. So there is no way that the operator can be compact. But there is one compact operator that you can make out of it. Namely, instead of acting by a single element of G of A, you can operate by an element of CC infinity of G of A, a compactly supported continuous function on G of A. Namely, you sort of integrate the right regular actions against the compactly supported continuous function. Okay, so I am being very informal here. We are not going to need any of this, but it's nice to kind of know it. Okay, so what they do is that if you have a compactly supported smooth function on G of A, CC infinity of G of A, you can talk of its right regular action. And you can ask if that is a compact operator. So it's not going to be a compact operator on L2, but it will be a compact operator on the space of cusp forms L02. Okay. And in fact, if you remember the proof of Peter Weyl theorem for compact groups, that was exactly how you prove that, the Peter Weyl theorem for compact groups. Namely, you make CC of the group act on the group by right regular action and show that that operator is compact. Okay. So this is in some sense a generalization of that idea, but you have to restrict to the space of cusp forms to get a compact operator. Okay. So sorry that it took a long time. Maybe I shouldn't have spent so much time just explaining, but let us go ahead. Okay. So what we want is the next step is that, okay, so I again spent too much time on representation theory. Let us get to number theory because this is all about number theory. So what do we want? Given an automorphic representation pi comma w, we want to define what it means to factorize it as a tensor product over places. Because at one time, we only want to worry about one place, okay? And then we want to define an L function because after all, that is what we would like to do, right? So we want to define an L function as the product of L functions, as an Euler product, okay? So this is our next aim. So first we'll see how this works for GL1, okay, instead of GL2. Okay, what is GL1 of A? Remember that GL1 of A is the group of ideals, and it was the set of all XV where XV belongs to QV star, and for almost all P, XP should belong to ZP star, right? This was the definition of ideals. And for each place V, QV star sits inside A star, right? Namely, if you have X in QV star, you put X at the place V and 1 at all the other places. Okay, so QV star sits inside A star. And suppose chi from A star to C star is a continuous character. Okay, so this is the generalization of a representation. This is a representation of GL1 of A. Namely, it is a character. And I want to recall how we define L functions for this setting. Okay, so first of all, you can get something. You can get something for GL. So this was a representation of GL1 of A. From that, we want to get a representation of GL1 of QV, right? Namely, you want to get a character of QV star. And how do you get a character of QV star from a character of A star? Well, QV star sits inside A star, and you just compose with the inclusion. So you get a character chi V of GL1 of QV, which is QV star, okay? And then it is easy to see that chi p satisfy the following property. Because chi is continuous, you can show that there exists a finite set S of primes, so that if p does not belong to S, then chi p is a particularly nice kind of character. Namely, it is trivial on zp star. Okay, so chi p is a character of qp star, which is further trivial on zp star. So an easy consequence of this is as follows. Whenever X is a tuple XV V, you can write chi of X as the product of XV V. Okay, so this is a consequence of the fact that I had stated. So remember, we wanted to factorize a representation pi as a product of local objects pi V. So this is the GL1 case of that. If you have a character chi of GL1 of A, you can factorize it in some sense as a product of characters of QV star. Okay, so chi can be reconstructed from the chi V. Namely, we write chi as this is the notation, we write chi as tensor chi V if we can write this. Okay, and then here is how we defined L functions in the GL1 case. Namely, for those P such that chi P, right, we define chi V for every V, so you have chi P. If chi P is trivial on ZP star, we define L of S comma chi P to be 1 minus chi of P over P raised to S inverse, right? So this is the analog of the fact that in the Euler product expansion of the Riemann zeta function, you have 1 minus 1 by P raised to S inverse. And in the Dirichlet character, similarly, you had 1 minus chi of P by P raised to S inverse. If chi P is not trivial on ZP star, we declare the L function to be just 1. Okay, formally, we define L of S chi as the product of L of S comma chi P. Okay, just formally, because we don't know if this converges or not. Okay, and does this sort of thing converge? No, not in the least. This does not converge at all, because this is a horrible thing to consider. Chi P can be anything that you want, right? Given pretty much any chi P, you can cook up a chi which gives these bad values. So why does the theory work? All the beauty and glory happens when chi, the character chi which is on A star, is actually trivial on the subgroup Q star. Okay, that is the meaning of saying that chi is not just a character of A star, but chi is actually a character of A star mod Q star, namely chi is automorphic. Okay, then you can expect something like this, because we are in the setting which is very similar to that of Dirichlet characters. Okay, so let me repeat. Okay, so some of you must have been tired hearing this from me many times. If you just look at a character of A star or a representation of GL2 of A, you are not doing number theory, you are doing harmonic analysis. If you say that your character is trivial on Q star, or your representation is an automorphic representation in the sense that I defined earlier, then you come into the realm of number theory, and suddenly the L functions, these arbitrary kind of L functions, start behaving nicely, and they give us number theoretic results. Okay, so if chi is trivial on Q star, then one can prove convergence for large real part of S, And real for real part of S greater than 1 if chi is unitary, okay, like the Riemann zeta function. And moreover, if chi is automorphic, otherwise chi, this, these things have no good properties, you can prove various things like meromorphic function, continuation, functional equation, and so on. Okay. And how is this related to Dirichlet characters that we discussed? In lecture 3, for every Dirichlet character underlying chi, now I'm kind of separating it in notation, we saw how to obtain a chi on A star, right? The two are related in the following fashion. L of S comma underlying chi inverse is equal to L of S comma chi, okay? Provided chi is primitive. Remember that there is a fine print there. This is not true unless chi is primitive, which is natural, right? Because if you pull back chi and make it non-primitive, you get a different Dirichlet L function. Whereas those two give you the same character of A star, right? So this statement would be wrong if it were not primitive, okay? So I just repeated that statement here. Now you might be wondering, why do we have something like chi inverse? The reason is as follows. You can check that chi p is unramified if and only if p. So remember, we started with underlying chi, which was a primitive character on Z mod and Z star. Okay, and we defined chi from there. And from chi, you had various chi p's. And the question is whether chi p was trivial on Zp star or not, right? That was the definition of the L function. Remember, the L function was different depending on whether chi p was trivial on Zp star or not. So chi p being unramified detects exactly whether p divides n or not. And if p does not divide n, then chi p is unramified, and the relation between them you can check is this, okay? So some other authors define the correspondence between Dirichlet characters and ideal class characters in a different way. They will get the result L of S chi equals L of S underline chi equals L of S chi, but that's a question of notation, okay? So all I'm saying is there is no mystery here, but you should be wary of different people using different conventions, okay? So just by working over the ideals with A star over Q star, Tate was able to reprove various classical number theory results of L functions, okay? So many classical results can be done idealically using harmonic analysis over A, okay? So instead of working over R mod Z and so on, there is one more chat question, it looks like, Saurabh.
There is a comment from Professor Ghate. He said that all of theories goes back to Hecke.
Ah, yes. You said that
already. Sorry. I said it a little early. You said Tate recovered these results.
So Tate recovered these results. I should have said that they were due to Hecke. So now we would like to have a glimpse of how all this works for GL2. Okay. So we want to start with the representation of GL2 of A. Remember, when I say a G of AF cross G comma K infinity module, I'm informally thinking of it as a representation of GL2 of A, right? G of A. Okay. So you have an irreducible admissible G of AF cross G K infinity module. So we want to define, so given a character chi in the GL1 situation, we defined the notion of, we defined various chi p's, right? There, chi p's were just a character of QP star. Here, the chi p's are going to be the what are called irreducible admissible representation of GL2 of QP. So I need to recall what is the meaning of an irreducible admissible representation of GL2 of QP, okay? So let me just define that notion. So suppose you have a representation pi v of GL2 of QP on a complex vector space. So GL2 of a QP is a group. You can think of its representations on some complex vector space. You say that it is smooth if every vector V is fixed by some compact open subgroup of G of QP. Okay. So this is exactly like our statement that an automorphic form had to be fixed under the right regular action of some compact open subgroup of GL2 of finite ideals. Okay. So this is the notion of a smooth representation. And suppose your representation is already smooth, the meaning of that representation being admissible, again, let me tell you, we won't have to work with the definition of admissibility, but we should at least see the definition because that word is going to come. if for each compact open subgroup K prime contained in G of QP, the subspace of V consisting of K prime fixed vectors is finite dimensional, right? So earlier we defined multiplicity in terms of some irreducible representations of K prime having multiplicity. So here this is like the trivial representation of K prime should have finite multiplicity in V. That is K prime fixed vectors subspace is finite dimensional. Okay, but earlier I had defined a different notion of admissibility, and you can check that this definition of admissibility is also analogous to that definition of admissibility. Namely, whenever you have any compact open subgroup K prime and any irreducible representation of K prime, it should occur in V only finitely many times. Okay. Thus, this is indeed a periodic analog of what we had earlier seen for GK infinity modules and G of AF cross G comma K infinity modules. So two reasons why smoothness is not a bizarre condition, right? I am saying that every vector should be fixed by a compact open subgroups. So you might ask, is there any such thing as a compact open subgroup? Of course, we had seen that for G of AF. So let me just say that we have actually lots and lots and lots of compact open subgroups in GL2 of QP, because you can look at all the integer matrices which are congruent to the identity modulo P raised to n, okay? So for any n, you can look at all the integer matrices which are congruent to identity modulo P raised to n. And remember, in the periodic topology, divisible by a large power of P means very small. The absolute value of P raised to n was P raised to minus n, okay? So all these elements should be thought of as very close to the identity. And if you look at their intersection, the matrices which are congruent to identity modulo n for every n is just the identity matrix, okay? So GL2 of QP has a neighborhoods which are all compact open subgroups. There are too many compact open subgroups, okay? So its topology is locally compact, Hausdorff, and totally disconnected, okay? So you will see things like locally constant functions in this setting, right? If your space was connected, you don't want to talk about locally constant functions usually, but here things are totally disconnected. So there are lots of such functions. And secondly, is the property that I had said, this smoothness is only an analog of what you had already seen for automorphic forms. Okay. So, So now the rest of the talk, I'm going to do the following. Earlier, we started with a chi, which was a character of A star, and we defined what it meant for chi to be a product of various chi V. I just want to discuss what is the representation theoretic analog of that. Okay. We will mostly not need the formal definition, but it is good to see the formal definition because it will actually give you some sort of comfort with these sorts of notions. So let me give you some sketch of the formal definition. Okay, so suppose pi is a G of AF cross G comma K infinity module. We want to factor it into various pi V, okay? Where pi P is a representation of G of QP and pi infinity is a G comma K infinity module. Okay, so remember, if you have an irreducible representation of G1 cross G2. So in the representation theory of finite groups, we see this result. If you have a representation of G1 cross G2, which is irreducible, you can write it as irreducible representation of G1 tensored with irreducible representation of G2. Okay. So, and G of A is some sort of direct product of G of QP with some restrictions. And similarly, this is also going to be some sort of a restricted direct product of irreducible representations of the individual local pieces. Okay. So for that, I'll first describe how to build up a pi from the various pi V. Okay. Suppose you are given the following data. The first is, for each finite prime P, you are given an irreducible admissible representation of GL2 of QP. Okay, I defined what is admissibility. At the infinite prime, you are given one single irreducible admissible GK infinity module pi infinity comma V infinity. Okay, from this, we want to build up a representation pi, which is a G of AF cross G comma K infinity module. Okay, but actually we need some more restrictions, because remember, for a character chi of A star, we observed that most of the chi P's were trivial on ZP star, which was GL1 of ZP, we are going to need an analogous condition for these representations. So we require that for all P outside some finite set S0, we are given one non-zero vector in the representation WP. Remember, WP is the representation at P of GL2 of QP. We are given one non-zero vector, which is fixed by KP, which is GL2 of ZP. Okay. It looks like a bizarre condition, but it's going, it's a very important condition. I mean, very, it's a condition which will show up tomorrow also. It is, this condition will show up when we try to interpret Hecke operators idealically. Okay. So it's something very important. So in particular, we are assuming that for all P outside this finite set S0 of places, we are assuming that WP has at least one GL2 of ZP fixed vector. Okay. So this is analogous to the fact that earlier, remember, so I'm kind of in two minds whether I should go back or not. Okay, so let me go back. See, when we had a character chi of A star, we saw that there exists a finite set S of places such that if P is outside S, then chi P restricted to ZP star is one, right? So we need an, so this is an analog of that condition. When you say that chi P restricted to GL1 of ZP is one, you are saying that in the representation space of chi P, GL1 of ZP has a fixed vector. Okay, so this is exactly the analog of that. Okay. So we are assuming that for all P outside this finite set S0, there is at least one vector which is fixed by GL2 of ZP, in which case you know, it is known that the space of GL2 of ZP fixed vectors is actually one dimensional. And in this case, we say that pi P is unramified because this is exactly the condition that is analogous to chi being chi P being unramified, okay? So this is the datum that we are given, okay? At each finite place, we are given pi P and WP, which is a representation of GL2 of QP. At the infinite place, we are given one GK module pi infinity W infinity. And at most places, we are given a vector WP, which is fixed by GL2 of ZP outside, for all those P outside this finite set. Okay, so what are we going to do now? Given this datum, we want to construct a representation of G of AF, which we will denote as tensor over P pi P and tensor prime over P W P. Okay. We'll also write it as pi F comma W F. And then you have this W F, you also have W infinity. W F is a G of AF representation. W infinity is a G K infinity module. Okay. And just like tensor product of a representation of G1 with a representation of G2 is a representation of G1 cross G2, WF tensor W infinity will be G of AF cross G of GK infinity module. Okay. Any questions? We are going to do this. Okay. We haven't constructed pi F WF. Once we do this, we'll get this module W, which is a G of AF cross GK infinity module. Question? Questions?
No question till yet.
Okay, thanks. Okay, so let me briefly describe how to construct pi f comma wf. Okay, so again, roughly speaking, remember this is nothing. Like, you know, we are g of af is like the direct product of qp. So you, it is like you are taking a tensor product of the wp. Okay, but it is only a restricted direct product, so the tensor product should also be restricted. Okay, so I'm just sketching how to formalize that. Okay, suppose S is a finite set of finite primes containing S0. Okay, so for any such finite S, we are going to consider the following, namely product P element of S G of QP that acts on tensor product of P element of S WP, right? Because each WP is a representation of G of QP. Okay, so ignore the blue statement for blue thing for now. Okay, the black product over pi element of S G of QP acts on tensor product P element of S WP. Now you tag on this blue thing, cross product P element of S G of ZP, and just say that it acts trivially on this tensor product, right? Nothing prevents you from making a group act trivially. Okay, but how do we think of this? We informally think of this group this in the following fashion. The product P element of S G of QP cross product P naught element of S G of ZP is the same as G of A F comma S. Okay, and instead of thinking of this as tensor product P element of S WP, we think of it as tensor product P element of S capital WP tensored with, for every prime outside S, we have a single vector WP that has been given, right? That was part of the datum, and that WP was fixed by G of ZP. Okay, remember, we are given, the last datum was that for all P outside a finite set S0, we are given WP is a vector fixed by GL2 of ZP. Okay, so here, for all P not element of S, P is certainly outside S0 because S contains S0, and therefore WP is fixed by G of ZP. So you can think of it as product G element of QP cross product P not element of S G of ZP acting on this tensor product. But this is informal, right? What does the right hand side of 3 even mean? Okay, but WP is a single vector, so you can think of the right hand side of 3, whatever it should mean, is in bijection with the right hand side of 2. Okay, now the left hand side of 2 and 3, you know, G of AF comma S increases with S. You allow the coordinate to be G of QP at more and more places, and the restriction that it be in G of ZP is at fewer places, right? So both 2 and 3 increase with S. On the other hand, think of the informal perspective, right hand side of 3, you can think of it as increasing with S, right? When you replace S1 by S2, you are allowing more of the little WPs to be replaced by the capital WPs. Okay, capital WP is bigger than small WP. So if you think of the right hand side, it is the informal picture, it is actually increasing with S. Okay, so formally the right hand side can be thought of as increasing with S. So we think of all these elements in the right hand side as belonging to the same vector space, same big vector space, take their union. Okay, and on each of them, so on the Sth vector space, G of AFS acts. So if you take the union of G of AFS, it acts on the union. Okay, so that's roughly the idea. You won't need to remember the fine print. It is okay if you don't remember the details. But remember, all we are doing is the following. G of AF is a restricted tensor product. And accordingly, we are taking some sort of a restricted tensor product of representations. And that involves this additional thing. For all but finitely many places, you're fixing one vector, which is fixed by G of ZP, okay? And that involves a condition of unramifiedness. There is a way to make this intuitive idea precise, starting from 2, because 2 is not informal. 2 makes sense formally, 3 was informal. So you think informally using 3 and make 2 precise and replace the word union with direct limits. You know, as S varies, you construct maps from the various tensor products of WPs using the little WPs. So you can make this thing precise, and therefore it is possible to get a representation pi F on which there is an action of G of AF. Okay, we will call this space tensor prime of product P, finite P WP, and we'll also call it WF. The representation will be called pi F as well as tensor over P pi P. Okay, so this is the notion of so I have discussed how to get a pi F comma WF, which is a representation of G of AF. We also have a representation pi infinity comma W infinity, which was a G comma K infinity module. So you have this W infinity, you have this WF, and their tensor product is a G of AF cross G comma K infinity module. Okay. So we call this tensor product as pi f tensor pi infinity comma wf tensor w infinity, or we can call it tensor product over all the places of pi v and the tensor prime over v wv, where tensor prime remembers that it was only a restricted tensor product that we started with. Okay, so here is a theorem. Okay, it is due to Flath in this generality. Given any datum as above, local pi p wp and the choice of the little wp for p outside a finite set of places, pi infinity and w infinity, I just described how to construct pi comma w, which was a g of af cross g comma k infinity module. Okay, so remember that each pi infinity was admissible, each pi p was admissible, pi infinity was also admissible, and the theorem says that the pi comma w is also admissible. Okay, so if you take a tensor product of restricted tensor product of irreducible admissible, what you get is also irreducible admissible. That's the first statement. Second statement is that whenever you have any irreducible admissible pi comma w, you can write it as a restricted tensor product of the pi v comma wp, provided this extra datum of wp for p outside is given, and each of the individual pi p's and pi infinities are going to be irreducible isomorphic admissible and determined up to isomorphism. Okay, so that was the last slide. Did I go over time? No. Okay, so I am well within time. So in the second part of the theorem, instead of can be written as, I should have written is isomorphic to. Okay, so things are only well determined up to isomorphism. Okay, so a general irreducible admissible g of af cross g comma k infinity module can be factored into objects over local places. Okay, so next time I'll discuss how to assign local L functions in a very ad hoc manner, just like in the one dimensional case.
I have a question. Sorry, this V and P are, this V and,
sorry,
here this V and P are same.
V and P, where, in which line?
Theorem, second statement.
Second statement, no. So to take the rest, so to get something over the ideals, I need things over P, all the finite primes P, and also one over the Archimedean prime infinity, right? So when I write V, I mean that V is ranging over all places, finite as well as the infinite place infinity. When I write P, it is only ranging over the finite places. Okay, is that okay?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So anything can be factored. So you see, today in the GL1 case, several slides ago, I defined the L function in a very ad hoc manner, right, at the beginning. So somewhat similarly, I'll describe irreducible admissible representations of GL2 of QP and describe L functions in a very ad hoc way, which might even horrify people because it's not conceptual. And then I'll describe, so then we can define the L function of the original representation pi as a product of the local L functions. And then again, it is not going to converge at all unless the representation is automorphic. And we will discuss how to relate Hecke eigenvalues to L functions as described ad hocly. And I mean, at least at places which are unramified. And we'll also see how to recover those L functions, at least at those places, more conceptually at the unramified places, okay, using representation theory. Okay, and then hopefully, if I get, I hope I'll be able to discuss the representation theoretic formulation of the Ramanujan conjecture and maybe a few other sundry results. Okay, so that is what I hope to do tomorrow. For today, I'm stopping. Any questions?
Any questions or comments?
So please feel free to give me feedback that I was fast at this place or that place or whatever.
So, sir, I have one question.
Yeah.
If you don't have automorphic representation, means if you don't quotient out, means if you take the automorphic representation by discrete groups, GLQ, let's say GQ.
If you don't quotient out by GQ, so your representation is not automorphic. Is that the question? Or sorry?
Okay.
Hello.
Hello. No, I mean, if you don't quotient out and do it same thing like and GA, you consider like representation.
Yeah.
And consider them a restricted tensor product, and can you attach a local L function?
Yes, you are telling that we are actually doing now, right?
Yeah.
See, what did we do in the one-dimensional case? We started with a random chi. Okay, it was not automorphic, right?
Yes.
We started with a horrible continuous chi, And yes. then we said that if chi is automorphic,
yes,
then the Euler product is going to converge.
Yeah.
Otherwise, so, the Euler product will be very random.
So, okay? Indian
Similarly, also, here mm. also, I did not assume that pi is automorphic. Okay. So, okay. I started with...
My question is that if even it's not automorphic, can you attach a local L function?
Yes, yes, yes. Because you see, in the last statement, you see,
yeah, yeah.
what did I write? Given any irreducible admissible pi comma w,
yes, yes.
not automorphic, it is yeah. just irreducible admissible.
Yes.
You can factor it. And mm-hmm. once you factor it, you have the local L functions and you can claim to define the product. Okay. But okay. that product will not have good properties. And so the magic is that the moment okay. it is automorphic, it is going to have good properties.
Okay. Given any representation, you can define a L function, you're telling.
You can define a formal product. Okay.
No.
But that product will not converge, will may not converge anywhere in the complex plane.
And local field. G of QP. If it
yeah, means... yeah. So any irreducible admissible representation you can. Because you okay. see, when I define the local L function, I'm not going to remember whether it came from something automorphic or not.
Okay.
I'm going to just take an irreducible admissible representation and define an L function.
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks. Any other question?
Any other questions or comments?
Yeah, or criticisms.
So are the pi infinities in the GK module, yeah. are they going to be unitary finally or not?
Yeah, because you see the L2, the right regular representation on L2 is unitary.
Right.
So every local representation that arises is going to be unitary from this setting. Okay. But it is the converse is not true in the sense that the unitary irreducible admissible representations may not arise from automorphic forms. So that's related to the formalism of Arthur packets.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Is that also true for, that also happens for GL2?
So people do pursue the local representation theory without assuming unitariness because there is also a lot of stuff there.
Yes.
But often people, whatever arises from the automorphic setting is kind of a specific subclass of the unitary setup.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah. Thanks.
Any more questions or comments? So if not, we will thank the speaker for such wonderful lectures.
Thank you.
We will have one virtual lunch break, yes. Then we will assemble at 2:15.
So I'll stop sharing.